Thank you so much, Pastor Devo. Well, good morning and happy Sabbath, La Sierra Church community. In case you don't know me well, or you don't know me at all, I'll tell you about my roots here at La Sierra. So starting way back before I was born, my parents worked on their master's degrees here in the late 1970s while they were academy teachers. Now, while I grew up in Arizona, I came to La Sierra as a freshman in 1998, and I have never left. I mean, I have left temporarily for a year or so to go teach English in Taiwan or to do my research in the Philippines, which is my research area. But my permanent address here at La Sierra has never changed. Though you can never take the Arizona boy out of me, I'd like to say that I've had a full La Sierra blood transfusion. I graduated from the university in 2002, started teaching here in 2003, got married right on this platform 20 years ago next month by Pastor Devo. My wife was baptized here. Both of my daughters were born and dedicated and baptized here. So you are my people, my family. That's my daughters probably applauding there. So you are my people, my family, my tribe. So if I can be safe anywhere inside a spiritual community, it will be here. With that being said, I'm going to speak some hard words. Now, don't get me wrong, these are not going to be the hard words of Isaiah or Jeremiah or the other major prophets laying a harsh smackdown on the religious communities of their day. These are going to be hard words for me to say, and perhaps hard ones for you to hear, because I'm going to talk to you about pain and about abuse and about mental illness and about despair, so kind of like Jeremiah. But growing up as I did in the 80s in a very conservative Arizona Adventist environment, these things were not polite topics for conversation. They were not to be voiced out loud. They were not to be acknowledged or even contemplated. So what I'm going to say to you today will be painful, for me certainly, and maybe also for you, if anything that I share triggers any physical or emotional memory. My journey will probably be different from yours in many ways, but I've chosen to be open and vulnerable here in an attempt to normalize these kinds of conversations, to bring them out of the shadows, to illustrate just how common, just how insidious, and how damaging these things can be when they remain just below the surface of a seemingly healthy, happy, and well-adjusted person. Jesus tells us in Luke 12, verse 2, that there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed or hidden that will not be known. William Shakespeare put similar words into the mouth of the young Lancelot Gobbo in The Merchant of Venice when he says, "But at the length truth will out." If you notice rust spreading on your car or on a metal surface inside your home, you may think, well, it's a good idea just to paint over that, out of sight, out of mind, right? But painting over rust merely accelerates the process of corrosion and decay. Truth is the same. You may paint it over, but it will out. And as Jesus tells us, hidden is not a healthy place for truth to be, whether under a bushel like a lamp or buried in the ground like a talent. So in order to not hide the truth, much of my own journey with trauma and mental illness, I've shared with my daughters and my wife both the stories and, unfortunately, the suffering, as many things have been passed down from me to them. And that is truly the sins of the fathers being visited upon the children to the third and fourth generation. As a way to help me out, and because concepts are more easily understood if they come through more than one of our five senses, my daughter Carmina agreed to illustrate this talk. So let's start from the very beginning. When my mother was pregnant with me, my father, who was, among other things, a serial cheater, also physically and emotionally abused her. Now, when someone is under a tremendous amount of stress, stress hormones are released into the body, including cortisol, the one we probably know most about. Pregnant mothers share pretty much everything with the baby through the umbilical cord, and so anything present in the maternal circulation will almost immediately become part of the fetal circulation, including the cortisol that you see in red here in this illustration. Studies over the last 45 years have shown that fetuses whose mothers display excessive cortisol levels during pregnancy, especially at the wrong time during pregnancy, have greatly increased risks of stress-related diseases later in life, including depressive, anxiety, heart, and immune system disorders. From what I have gathered from talking to my mother and other family members about that time, I experienced a fully submerged 9-month-long cortisol bath. Moving to early infanthood, when I was just a few months old and breastfeeding, my father informed my mother that the coworker he was currently having an affair with was pregnant. At that point, my mother's milk instantly dried up. However, she continued trying to breastfeed me. It was when I began to precipitously lose weight that they took me to the doctor, who told them to bottle feed me as I was starving to death. My mom tells me that she's thankful that I was such a quiet and easy baby, otherwise she doesn't know how she could have coped during that difficult time in her life. I've been told by other relatives that she was nearly catatonic through those first year or two, so I'm not sure whether I really was quiet or easy. What I did discover early on, however, that is if I needed something, whether food or a diaper change or affection or comfort, nobody was coming. This put me and has continued to keep me to the present day in a constant state of famine. We often think as a famine as an extreme state of food insecurity, and that is true, but we can think of famine also as being a state of scarcity and lack of security in other ways. Certainly food was a factor. My brother and I grew up in two different homes with different blended families in each, and often with very different sets of rules, which were sometimes hard to keep straight. What was required in one home was forbidden in the other. In one home, they fed us regular meals. In the other, not so much. And asking for food there often got you a scolding. But as I said, there are other aspects to famine and scarcity. You can be starved for affection. We know that humans require healthy physical touch, and we also know that a lack of or inconsistent application of verbal affirmation can stunt emotional growth and lead to unhealthy patterns of needing to earn the love and regard of others. There is also spiritual abuse and famine. Growing up in an Adventist community in Arizona during the conservative backlash of the early 1980s, there was a particular obsession with end time events and the need to prepare for the time of trouble. My two most vivid sensations and memories from a childhood spent in church are, one, oddly enough, being very cold all the time, and two, being very afraid, usually as I attempted to cover my ears during yet another end times related sermon. Now, I am sure they meant well, and they were hoping to scare us straight into heaven. But there is still no visual element more guaranteed to strike dread in my heart than a picture of the second coming. Deep into my 20s, I suffered recurring nightmares of fleeing from government agents after the Sunday laws had been passed, or convinced that mankind would have to live without an advocate. I also dreamed initially hopeful scenes like this of the second coming that turned into terror when I learned that there was just one little sin left upon my record, and I was now one of the people who would be cast into the lake of fire. On top of all of this, if you happen to suffer from anxiety or depression and sought help from family, friends, or church leaders, you were often accused of displaying a sinful lack of faith, because God would certainly cure you if you were simply faithful and devoted, if you would just claim the promises found in Scripture. Much later in my life, when I learned more about mental illness, I would somewhat sarcastically answer people who said this to me, "So when you fell off that ladder and broke your leg, how much prayer and fasting did it take for God to heal you?" Again, growing up in two homes didn't help, since one was Adventist and the other Southern Baptist. So the uniquely Adventist doctrine you dutifully learned in Sabbath school would make you a very unwelcome presence in Sunday school. with the added benefit of being assured of eternal damnation in two religious traditions. So you can probably guess that I became a very nervous and anxious kid, constantly on edge and vigilant, always keeping an eye out for threats, always reading the room to feel the prevailing mood, trying to tune in to other people's emotional states. Now, strangely enough, these survival instincts have actually made me a much better classroom teacher than I would have been otherwise. So, you know, lemons and lemonade. But regardless, all of this did not endear me to everyone. Many people could not understand me and were often angry and annoyed. And here, I want to stop and caution the parents in the room or others who have mentoring relationship with children, uncles, aunts, grandparents, foster parents, honorary parents, even and maybe even especially pastors and teachers. I want to caution you that the things you tell your kids in anger and frustration or grumble under your breath almost immediately become the things that your kids tell and believe about themselves. It forces them away from being the most open, honest, and authentic version of themselves and bends them into an unnatural shape. For me, I learned to be very quiet, very obedient, keep my head down, and above all, perform at the highest level I could to keep people in my orbit happy. So how does a kid live being bent out of shape like this? Well, honestly, for myself, I really didn't live. I coped by spending most of my time alone in rooms with books and with my own imagination. Taking the ring to Mordor with Frodo, Sam, and Gollum seemed a lot safer than my regular everyday life, despite the fact that I lived in lower middle class American comfort. When spending time at my father's house, for instance, my most consistent friends and companions were the group of kids in the Peanuts comics. I felt the most affinity for two characters, Linus, who dealt with debilitating insecurity, and Charlie Brown, who dealt with debilitating insecurity. My daughter, Mina, made this panel for me in the style of Peanuts, which is part of a larger strip where Charlie Brown says that he worries too much, and then he worries that he might be worrying too much, and worries what will happen if he worries too much about worrying, finally concluding that even his anxieties have their own anxieties. So how did I do after childhood and adolescence? Well, my unhealthy coping mechanisms of pleasing everyone and pushing myself to achieve continued into adulthood in the more adult realms. From the outside, I'm sure it looked very successful. As we can see in this animation, from this perspective, from behind, I appear to be passing various mileposts of education, earning various academic degrees, mileposts of life, such as starting a family, buying a home, pursuing a career. All of this is part of a healthy striving toward the golden light of self-improvement, personal growth, and career development. Kind of like the commercials you see on TV when they're trying to convince you to go back to school and get your MBA. But reality is much darker. Let's flip the script. While all of this striving may have had the accidental result of providing these things, in truth, they're simply the result of a desperate and endless attempt to keep ahead of the dreadful specter of famine. So I would love to say that all of these achievements were prompted primarily by noble causes, but in actuality, it was just mostly terror. So this brings me to a second caution or warning for all of us in our religious community. We know the common saying, don't judge a book by its cover. In the same way, we shouldn't judge a person's mental or emotional state only by external cues. Now, while some people may appear sad or disappointed or angry or any number of a range of emotions, many others of us have become subconsciously adept at hiding it, often because we were not traditionally allowed to demonstrate negative emotions. For me, when I finally received proper diagnoses and started treatment about 10 years ago, many of my family and closest friends were shocked, having no clue that I'd suffered from any mental illness. On the one hand, I was sort of pleased, at first thinking, Well, at least nobody noticed that I was falling to pieces. But on the other hand, I was terrified, thinking, nobody noticed that I was falling to pieces. Just mere millimeters behind the external veneer that many of us consciously or unconsciously present is often a very different reality, one we may be ashamed to expose. But if one chooses to do so, let me add my last and final caution. Don't be a gatekeeper for trauma. Each of us is an individual with unique experiences, and if we are unfortunate enough to have experienced abuse or trauma, that is also unique. If, for instance, your own trauma included extreme poverty, that does not invalidate mine, which did not include poverty. A broken finger shouldn't be ignored simply because it isn't a broken arm. But we here at La Sierra have the opportunity, and I might add the responsibility, to be a place of openness, trust, and safety, eventually a place of healing and community where there is no shame because there is no fear. Well, finally, how did it work for me? Most of my adult life, I've been chasing physical symptoms, a cascade of somatic issues I call the roulette wheel. So first, several months of severe chronic heartburn, which we would medicate. Then several months of severe headaches, which we would medicate. Several months of severe fatigue, which we would medicate. And then months of, what do we have? There's so many. Weight loss or weight gain, which is where I am now. Tachycardia, and so on, around and around the wheel. We performed every test that insurance would cover, and it was always the same thing. Levels within normal range, nothing wrong with you. My doctor tells me that most mental health referrals come during a visit to the emergency room, when the physical somatic symptoms become an emergency. Fortunately, it didn't get to that point for me, but I was referred after a couple of years of chasing around the roulette wheel. Now, this has made all the difference in my life and in my family's lives too. While growing up, therapy, to say nothing of medication, was an absolute non-starter in my social and religious context. But things are much better now. Today, my daughters and I benefit from cognitive behavioral therapy, and Mina and I, Mina always draws me as a black cat for some reason, and Mina and I enjoy the improved mental and emotional stability afforded by Cymbalta and Zoloft. And we consider these medications to be gifts given by God. So coming to the end of what I have to say, I apologize that I haven't had more clever rejoinders and humorous remarks, but being clever and funny is also something that I have done to try and keep the famine and the darkness at bay. What I have hoped to do this morning is to help normalize the open discussion of trauma and mental illness, to advocate for mental health treatment when needed, to caution those of us in positions of power and authority to be aware of the positive and of the negative implications of what we say and what we do to those who are watching us, and to provide hope for those who are suffering, that there is help, that you are not alone, and that life can be bearable and even joyful. Thank you.
Yeah. I think I heard someone say, "Wow." Thank you, Dave, for being vulnerable and sharing. Here's a picture of Dave and myself in 2002, sitting in the back at La Sierra University Church, right at the back there. We were much younger, a little thinner, but we're more handsome right now. Dave and I have known each other for a long time, just over 22 years. This is March 8, 2002, when this picture was taken, when I was only 3 months a pastor in this community. This is now going on my 23rd year. You all have not kicked me out yet. Thank you. And Dave, so we're long friends, and Dave is one of the first people in a friendship group that befriended this then really thick South African accent guy here at Lossier and welcomed me into his friendship circles and made me feel comfortable here at Lossier. I had the honor, as David said, for officiating his and Sheila's wedding, dedicating children, all of these things happening right here at La Sierra. 22 plus years of friendship. And as you know, time, 22 years and time will teach us that the experience of the reality of life is that there are joys and there are struggles. Dave has been brave to share about his struggles with mental health and trauma. And if there's one thing that time has taught us, it is that suffering is inevitable, suffering is universal, and suffering causes pain to the individual experiencing it and those who care for them. In fact, as we talk about mental health and wellness, just recently, Pew Research had a study about a month ago that they published that showed the following graph up here, that close friends, therapists, and family members top the list of the people Americans would feel comfortable talking to about their mental health, which is a really good thing. But if you look carefully at the graph, it is one in two people that feel somewhat or very comfortable doing that. That means for half of our congregation here, we are comfortable to share, like Dave has, about his mental struggles. But the other half of us are not comfortable to share about that. And we live in darkness. In fact, the news had also talked in response to this study about the benefits of a religious community and growing up in a religious community, being part of a religious community for your mental health because of the community that is there. However, there's also a lot of talk about the church and mental health and that the church is not doing enough. More and more articles coming out that says the church needs to speak out about mental health because, historically speaking, the church has been predominantly silent or judgmental regarding mental health, especially American Christianity. This all stems back from the early church, where heroic martyrdom posture by the early church thought that suffering, they had this apocalyptic consciousness that the world was going to end soon, and so any suffering that you experience was temporary and for the goal of waiting for Jesus to come. So suffering was temporary, and the church discouraged complaining about worldly tribulations, any negative situation that you experienced, because you were not suffering with Christ. But not only the early church did this, the Reformed Church, John Calvin, John Wesley, Martin Luther, these giants in the theological world that shaped our evangelicalism today, they expressed that expressing anger against God or questioning God is sinful. No wonder we don't talk about our problems. And then, of course, in today's world, in Western culture, we have this self-help kind of attitude, this rugged individualist pull yourself up by your bootstraps mentality. And so in the church, with the history of negating any conversation about mental health and our culture and self-help, it results in the following things. The attitudes like this, where mental health issues are your fault. You just need to pray more. You just need to read your Bible more. You just need to attend church more. You need to tithe more. Or if you have mental health issues, it means you don't have enough faith. And this results, as Dave had talked, in guilt and shame and a cycle of, I feel bad, oh, I don't have enough faith, oh, I don't have enough faith, I feel bad about that, and the vicious cycle continues. And of course, the church has very often looked at medications as being the wrong thing. You don't need more meds, you need more Jesus. Of course, we know that taking medications is a wisdom issue, not a sin issue. And so Brené Brown sums up the context of the church and not speaking out about mental health really well when she says, if you put shame in a Petri dish, it needs three ingredients to grow exponentially: secrecy, silence, and judgment. And that has been the experience of the church and of many people suffering with mental wellness in the Christian community. And Dave talked about that. So for just a few minutes, we turn to the Word. We share stories, and then we turn to the Word to see how God's Word can speak to us after we listen to Dave's story. And I would like for us to go to the Psalms. Church, we can learn from the Psalms when it comes to mental wellness. The Psalms, of course, many of us know, is a collection of 150 ancient Hebrew poems and songs and prayers that all come from different parts of ancient Israel's history. And many of those poems were used by Israel in the temple. Choirs sang them, and they were cited in the temple. In the period after Israel's exile to Babylon, these ancient songs and prayers and poems were gathered together with all the other liturgy that they had put together and helped the church to worship. Now, there are many different psalms. There are psalms of thanksgiving, psalms of wisdom, psalms of pilgrimage, psalms of lament. There are eight or so categories of psalms, but there are two broad categories in the 150 psalms, and they are psalms of praise and psalms of lament. Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann speaks of Israel's testimony of faith existing in two equal planes that stand in sharp contrast with each other. He says, on the one hand, Israel voices a deep anguish and misery, lament. But on the other hand, Israel conveys a profound joy and celebration, praise. And both forms of expression is encouraged in Psalms. And so we turn to the Psalms because the Psalms teach us to neither ignore our pain nor to let it determine our lives. So, out of the 150 psalms, one-third of the psalms are psalms of individual lament. One-third of the psalms is individual lament. The word lament comes from, in the English word lament comes from the Latin lamenta, which means weeping. A third of your psalms is about weeping. These psalms have long been sung by God's people in the throes of sadness. They are the language of the distress, the heart cry of the anguished, and the familiar friend of the depressed. And while sometimes, or more often than not, we go to the Psalms in praise, we should also go to the Psalms when darkness will not lift. Lament, real and raw, is about questioning God's presence and questioning God's purpose. And a third of the psalm says, that is okay. So I want to read you a sampling of these lament psalms. There are many of them. We won't go through all of them. But here's a sample of the laments. Psalm 6, have mercy on me, Lord, because I'm frail. Heal me, Lord, because my bones are shaking in terror. My whole body is completely terrified. But you, Lord, how long will this last? Psalm 25, trust me, God, and have mercy on me because I'm alone and suffering. My heart's troubles keep getting bigger and bigger. Set me free from my distress. Have mercy on me, Lord, because I'm depressed. My vision fails because of my grief, as do my body and my spirit. My life is consumed with sadness. My years are consumed with groaning. Strength fails me because of my suffering. My bones dry up. Psalm 44, all day long my disgrace confronts me and shame covers my face because the voices of those who make fun of me and badmouth me because of the enemy who's out for revenge. Psalm 56, you yourself have kept track of my misery. Put my tears in your bottle, God. Aren't they on the scroll already? Psalm 57, my life is in the middle of a pack of lions. I lie down among those who devour humans. Their teeth are spears and arrows. Their tongues are sharpened swords. Psalm 77, I cry out loud to God so that he can hear me. During the day when I'm in trouble, I look for the Lord. At night, my hands are still outstretched and don't grow numb. My whole being refuses to be comforted. I remember God and I moan, I complain, and my spirit grows tired. Psalm 86, the last one. Lord, listen closely to me and answer me because I'm poor and I am in need. Have mercy on me, God, because I cry out to you all day long. Make your servant's life happy again. Wow. The Psalms of Lament are songs and poems in which the psalmist cries out to God in times of deep distress and despair. In Psalms of Lament, the psalmist asks God for intervention to deliver them from suffering and sorrow and loss and failures and enemy and depression and trauma and anxiety. These psalms express the darkest realities of life. Three things about the Psalms of Lament that I would like to share with you. First, the Psalms of Lament are about expressing despair that is embraced and encouraged by God and the community. As it is clear here, a third of the Psalms were used in corporate worship. We often sing Psalms of praise, but how often do we lament? In church, do we spend a third of our worship service lamenting? We don't, because American Christianity is triumphant about wanting to just praise God. The Psalms of Lament are about expressing despair. It is embraced and it is encouraged. It's a little bit like this picture that you'll see right here. This is a picture of the most painful despair that I ever had in my life. What you see there is not the solar eclipse or anything like that. That is a kidney stone. That kidney stone under the microphone, if you go to the next one, is only 2.5 millimeters in size. But it sure felt like a planet. I've had kidney stones 3 times. I know some of you here, Jim, you had it. Some of you had it. It is the worst pain in the world. And what happened when I had the kidney stone this time, you'll see a Facebook comment that comes up that I put on a Facebook comment after hundreds of people commented on my pain. I posted, Leilani, my wife says it's just as well that the kids are used to me screaming during soccer matches. They didn't seem worried with my screaming while I writhed on the floor in pain on Monday. Because I'd watch soccer and I'd go, England! Sorry, Stefan. That just happened. But when I had that planet going down my body, I was on the floor and I was going, and Leilani closed the door, put TV on for the kids so that they don't hear me. It was the worst pain I experienced in my life. And the only thing you can do when you have no other option is to moan. And we find now, studies have shown, that moaning, making a sound, actually causes the release of breath and exhalation. The noise resonates with the brain, potentially increasing the serotonin. And so it makes sense why we're in pain while we cry out. Some studies have actually shown in nursing, patients who yells and grunts or even cries may actually heal faster than those who just bite their upper lip and try and not cry. The Psalms encourage and embraces crying in despair to God, because anything we can bring, anything to God, our pain, despair, doubt, hate, anger, frustration, hopelessness, loneliness, depression, anything and everything the psalm says we can bring to God. There's nothing that cannot be lamented about in your personal life and in the church. Because after all, Jesus, faced with the cross, said, my God, why have you abandoned me? quoting directly from a Psalm of Lament 22. The Psalms of Lament are about expressing despair that is embraced and encouraged. And secondly, the Psalms of Lament are about expressing despair that happens in community. The Psalms of Lament happen in the safety of community. Like I said, this was public worship. These songs and poems about despair and questioning God and questioning the purpose in life was all done in the context of community. So firstly, Scripture teaches us that our depression and anxiety and our despair is embraced and encouraged by God. Secondly, we share it in community, because in community, there's accountability, there's hope, there should be courage and comfort. And thirdly, the lamenting Psalms teach us that expressing despair is entrusted to God. In all of these, one-third lamenting Psalms, all but two, we'll get back to that in a second, but all but two point their address to God. We have despair, we have anxiety, we have trauma, we have abuse, we have all of that, and Scripture encourages us to bring that before God, unashamed. The structure of Psalms of Lament are always, almost always like this, and it's an address to God, a complaint or a lament, a petition for help, a vow to trust, or a vow of praise. It always is in the context of bringing this to God. So as we summarize the Psalms of Lament, we can say that Psalms of Lament, lamenting about our anguish and pain and suffering, is embraced and encouraged in community before God. So we get back to this quote by Brené Brown and talking about the church. If you put shame in a Petri dish, it needs three ingredients to grow: secrecy, silence, and judgment. But if you put the same amount of shame in the Petri dish and douse it with empathy, it cannot survive. Church, we need to douse our community with empathy so that shame and guilt and secrecy and judgment cannot grow here, collectively and individually, so that when we have pain and anguish and mental struggles, we are not afraid to speak up, because we will be safe. We will have help. And we know God will listen to all of our cries, even when we doubt God. One last illustration. I read about this study this morning in Zimbabwe called the Grandmother's Bench. There's this bench in Zimbabwe. They've been struggling with mental health challenges in the southern African country, where poverty is rife and people cannot afford mental health care. And so this psychiatrist, Chibanda, actually came out with this idea, and it was born out of tragedy, because Chibanda, this young psychiatrist, is only one of just over 10 in Zimbabwe. This was back in 2005. One of these patients desperately wanted to see him, but she couldn't afford the $15 bus fare to come from afar to visit him. And Chibanda, the young psychiatrist, learned later that she had taken her life. He was so distraught and had his own anguish and despair that he couldn't help people, that he started Grandma's Bench, because he realized in community that grandmothers have wisdom, non-judgmental. Hopefully your grandmas are not non-judgmental. Wisdom and non-judgmental. They have empathy. They have a listening ear. They have experience. And so he created this bench and recruited and trained 10 grandmothers to sit on a bench so that people can come with their problems free of charge. This network is now expanded. In fact, here in the United States, there is a model. It's using this model in order to use it in the U.S. They've partnered with the World Health Organization and have grown over 2,000 grandmothers across Zimbabwe. And over 200,000 Zimbabweans sat on a bench to get therapy from a trained grandma in 2023. Wow. This grandma that's sitting on the bench there, Siridasi Zukwa, she says the following: people are no longer ashamed or afraid to openly stopping us on the street and asking us to talk. Mental health is no longer something to be ashamed of. Church should be a grandmother's bench. Amen? These pews, are grandma's bench, where we can turn to each other and listen with no judgment and no secrecy and no silence, because God has encouraged it. God asks us to do it in community and to bring it before God. Amen? Wow. Let's be that kind of church. For Dave, for half of us who are not comfortable talking about our mental health challenges, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. So church, traditionally we stand for the reading of the God's word before the sermon. Today we're gonna stand for the reading of God's word, don't do it yet, at the end of the sermon. I wanna share with you Psalm 88. The Psalms include psalms and laments that complain to God that has no resolution. And friends, it is blessed and encouraged by God. So I invite you now to please stand for the reading of God's word. And I invite you to think about your own life, the mental challenges that you struggle with, the friends or the family, the people in our community who you know, like Dave, struggled and there wasn't a listening ear. As we read the hearing of God's word, think about your life, about your struggles, about your pain, as we now bring a psalm of lament to God. Please listen for the word of God in Psalm 88. Lord, God of my salvation, by day I cry out. Even at night before you, let my prayer reach you. Turn your ear to my outcry, because my whole being is filled with distress. My life is at the very brink of hell. I'm considered as one of those plummeting into the pit. I'm like those who are beyond help, drifting among the dead, lying in the grave like dead bodies, those you don't remember anymore, those who are cut off from your power. You place me down in the deepest pit, in the darkest deep. Your anger smothers me. You subdue me with it, wave after wave. You made my friends distant. You made me disgusting to them. I can't escape. I'm trapped. My eyes are tired and looking at my suffering. I've been calling out to you every day, Lord. I have had my hands outstretched to you. Do you work wonders for the dead? Do ghosts rise up and give you thanks? Is your faithful love proclaimed in the grave, your faithfulness in the underworld? Are your wonders known in the land of darkness? Your righteousness in the land of oblivion? But I cry out to you, Lord. My prayers meet you first thing in the morning. Why do you reject my very being, Lord? Why do you hide your face from me? Since I was young, I've been afflicted. I've been dying. I've endured your terrors. I'm lifeless. Your fiery anger has overwhelmed me. Your terrors have destroyed me. They surround me all day long like water. They engulf me completely. You've made my loved ones and my companions distant. My only friend is darkness. The word of God.